If you want to quickly become a really cool Python programmer by joining the open source community with your very own Python library, then keep watching. I will explain the whole process in detail, share full code and documentation templates, and by the end of this video, you'll be able to publish your Python library into open source in no time. Senior developers from all over the world share their code with the community. And this is the power of open source. Of course, the cool factor that I mentioned at the start is not the only reason to invest the time to develop and maintain a Python package. Although one should not regret that this will be a distinguishing factor on your resume, almost immediately increasing the perception of your seniority level, even if it's not quite there yet. A better reason is to share a solution to a specific problem with the community. This creates an impact if there had not been an efficient way to do this before. Finally, if something that you've done resonates with a lot of people, you might just build a community around it. People will ask questions, find and fix bugs, join as collaborators. Who knows how big it might grow. There are many other good reasons, but I don't want to waste any more of your time. So let's get down to business. As an example, we'll build a simple password generator. The value of this code is close to nothing, but we want to keep this part as short as possible so that we'll have more time around the actual open sourcing problem. Here I'm gonna code the whole class. And this will be a B-roll with music. Now, I've deliberately did not go over all the methods that we've defined within this class because this is just plain simple and this is not the topic of today's video. Just a few things to keep in mind though. You want to keep your program clean of any commented parts, unnecessary print statements, and legacy code. Choose clear and self-explanatory names for all your arguments, functions, and variables. Don't create huge and messy functions. Instead, break your code down into small and easy-to-read parts which serve a single purpose. Validate arguments to make sure the user doesn't crash the program unintentionally. All the functions and methods need to have doc strings and track versions of your software. Now, if any of this is intimidating or you just want to refresh your Python skills, I will link the best Python courses down below, together with a course on version control, which is an essential part of any open source project. Now that we have our code, we need to add some additional files to this future Python library. You want to create a folder with your library name. I'm gonna call mine boilerplate code. And inside this folder, you want to create another folder with the same name, inside of which you're going to store your actual code. In addition to this, here you want to place the init.py and version.py. Inside the init.py, you want to define the import from your folder and from your password generator script, the password generator class. This way, when a user imports this library into their Python environment, they can easily access this class. Here you want to define the version index of your software. And as your program matures, you will increment it from the minority to the majority. Now let's move up the folder tree, and inside the major library folder, you need to have at least three of these files: license, readme, and requirements. Any software has a license, and you can Google the difference between the different types of licenses. In this case, I'm using a standard MIT license, which is a pure open source license. This way, anyone can use the software the way they want. Readme file in a restructured test format is going to just explain the basic stuff about your library. And let me show you how this looks. So in VS Code, you can install a restructured text plugin. And after having created your restructured text file, you can use this command right here to see how it's going to look like in the browser. As I mentioned, all these templates are going to be linked below, so you can just download them and modify them the way you like. Last thing in this folder is requirements. So if your library depends on a third-party package which doesn't come standard with Python, that means a user, in order to use your library, needs to have this third-party package, and you want to define them here in the requirements file. Now that we have all our files structured, the next thing we want to do is go to github.com and create an account if you don't have one yet. This is some hardcore verification. Since I already have a GitHub account, we're going to be using mine. So anywhere within your account, you've got this plus sign at the top. So just click it and select new repository. I already have a name for my library, so I'm going to call it boilerplate code. Just one important note here, public or private. Public repository is the one that anybody can access, and the private ones is for your private projects. I'm going to keep my public and create new repository. This is an empty repository. There's no data here yet.
So we need to move the folder that we have just structured into this repository. We are going to interact with GitHub through the command line. This is the easiest and fastest way for the developers to push their code into the remote repository. Most Apple computers come with Git installed, but this may not be true for Linux and Mac. To check whether you have Git installed, just open your terminal or the command line for Windows and print git that you have Git installed. You're going to see a really long help message. And if you don't, it's going to say command not found. In this case, just follow the link below for the official installation guide. Everything that this instruction tells us to do has to be done through the command line while being located inside the folder where you have your library. I'm going to be using iTerm2 instead of the built-in terminal, so let's navigate to our folder. Okay, here it is. Next, we want to initialize git. Great. And now we want to add a remote repository, this one right here. Let's just copy this. And there we go. All right. Git status is going to tell us that we have untracked changes. So these files are not yet pushed to the remote repository. We want to add them to the commit. So let's say git add, full stop, and check git status again. All right, very good. Now, make our first commit message. Initialize boilerplate core repo. Now git push. Okay, the error message tells us that this branch has no upstream branch. And here's the command that we need to use to make it happen. So let's just do that. And here we go. All our files have been pushed to the repository. Now let's have a look. I'm just gonna refresh this page. And here is our library. So our code is in here. Password generator init version. Let's have a look. Okay, now let's go back to the main page, and this is our readme. If you're wondering how did I get this picture here, just look inside the readme RST and you'll see a reference to this logo png file. Now the code that we have created is already in a GitHub repository and is available to the general public, but this is not exactly an open source library yet. This is just open source code which can be accessed by visiting your GitHub page. Now stop. This on its own is already a big step for those who have not been using version control. The main idea behind GitHub is to track all the changes to the code made by an individual contributor, in this case just by me, or by a team of collaborators connected to the same repository. You can see all the changes that you've made to your program line for line, and if something breaks, you can always find the commit that has caused it, or just revert to the previous state altogether. Serious software development cannot be done without version control. So if you want to be a programmer or a data scientist, regardless of your plans to release or not release an open source library, you should be using version control. By the way, if you want to learn how to become a data scientist, check out this awesome video right here. We still have some stuff to do, but this has already been a long video. So follow me into the next one, where we'll publish our library in the Python package index and create proper documentation, so that at the end it will look like a piece of professional open source software.